The following program is a public access production. Comcast is required to provide time on this channel and make it available pursuant to franchise agreements with the communities we serve. Comcast is not affiliated with the following program or the producers of public access programming and is not responsible for the content. The following program does not reflect the opinions of Comcast or its affiliates.
The radio show is about to begin. It might just ring a bell. Live local music with your host, Al Weissman. It's In a Nutshell.
Now, without further ado, I would like to introduce our guests of the day. Gentlemen, I would ask that each of you please step up to the mic. Say hello to our listening audience. Tell us what town and country you presently reside in and a little bit about yourself.
Hello, I'm Karl Green. I live in London, England, and I'm a former member of Herman's Hermits, the band that recorded one or two hits back in the 60s.
Welcome to our show, Karl.
It's nice to be back.
It's lovely. It's nice to have you.
And I'm Michael Bruccoleri, a resident of Valparaiso, Indiana.
Very cool. And also a guitar player, par excellence.
I own a guitar.
There you go. Last
but
not
least, shy. That's
I just
good.
Got hit in the head. I'm Connor Mahoney, and I'm from Chesterton, Indiana, and I'm nobody.
Woohoo, yes you are. You are somebody.
Maybe to you.
Without Connor, we all wouldn't be here with each
that's
other.
That's right.
That's true.
Thank you. Cool. So I just want to make you gentlemen aware of the fact that you may see a blue-haired beauty bopping around here today.
Oh, yes.
In our studio.
Oh, Al, I'm blushing.
That would be Marge Simpson.
My hair's turning orange. I'm so excited.
She's a regular member of my staff, so behave. And I wonder if I could prevail upon you gentlemen to lay a tune on us.
Sure. Right now?
Immediately, if not soon.
Okay, we'll do the first song that we ever recorded back in 64. This one features Mike on vocals, because I've grown up a lot since that day. I can't get the high notes. Funnily enough, I saw Peter the other day.
Oh, I was going to ask you about that.
He can still hit the high notes.
Oh, nice.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Well, he probably, you know...
He doesn't have to take estrogen, does he?
All the therapy and everything to keep the vocal cords in tone.
So, here we go. Think all I'm in something good.
1, 2, 3.
Shine.
I played the guitar solo.
Whoa, that is something great. Searing solo. Really nice. Now, Carl, when you were in our studio on Thanksgiving, this is Al Weissman, in a nutshell. That was Karl Green, original bassist of Herman's Hermits, and Mike Bruccoleri, both now known as the half of the Karl Green Band, also known as the KGB, singing I'm Into Something Good. When you were in our studio on Thanksgiving, we found out quite a bit about you at that time, in terms of history. There's a few things I'd like to catch up on. At that time in Thanksgiving, you advised us that you had formed this new group called the Karl Green Band, or the KGB, and that you were about to start work on a new album.
Yep.
The KGB was made up of yourself on bass and vocals.
That's right.
Bob Abrams on guitar and vocals.
Yep.
He was with you in the studio on Thanksgiving. Mike Bruccoleri on guitar and vocals, and Gina Knight on drums.
And vocals, yeah.
And vocals, okay. Yep. So how did you guys come together? How did you get the idea to start the KGB?
Well, after Mike and Connor brought me over last summer just to...
Mike Bruccoleri.
Yeah, Mike was instrumental in bringing me over last summer to play some gigs with his band.
Oh, that was fun.
Cool. Yeah, it was great. We played a few gigs around, you know, just for fun. Good, clean fun. And I realised that I didn't realise before that that the name Hermes Hermits still meant much over here.
I'm getting tons of hits on my announcements about today's show.
Oh,
yeah,
sure. Fantastic.
Because
yeah.
I posted all over the five county area, all kinds of different websites and distant locations, and people are just banging away on it.
Right. And I was amazed at the reception. So and because at home my children are all grown up, left home, they've all got their own homes, and I thought it'd be nice to come over here and start playing again.
Cool.
So,
is there a wife somewhere around?
I've got a wife at home, yeah, but she won't come out to the States.
She doesn't like
the States.
She's been here.
She came out in the 70s for a while.
Okay, we won't hold that against you.
She's got her own business in London.
Come on over here and visit. We were over there visiting your place. The least you could do is give us a visit.
But my girls are with
me. 70s, things have changed. It's been 45 years, for crying out loud. It's a whole different country over here.
Oh, yeah, my girls are... Can't wait to come over because I want to settle over here. So they make the girls may come and visit, and as soon as I get my immigration status sorted and my work visa sorted and all that sort of stuff, I've got a lot of business to sort out while I'm here this time.
What, can you play us another tune?
Definitely can. Yeah.
Please.
What would you like? How about Can't You Hear My Heartbeat?
That sounds great.
Okay.
Right, Connor, you have to be on. Woo! One, two, three, four.
Oh. Weissman. In a nutshell, that was Karl Green, original bassist for the Herman's Hermits, with Mike Bruccoleri, two of the four members of the Karl Green Band, playing Can't You Hear My Heartbeat?
And
Herman's
Connor Hermits was woohooing.
And yes, Marge was woohooing at times. So now, Bob Abrams, Mike Bruccoleri, and Gina Knight are all U.S.-based artists.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, they all live in the Chicagoland area. Was that why you decided to, when you wanted to form a new band, to do it in the United States instead of jolly old England?
Yeah, well, I've got a band in England as well, but
okay.
I'm not trying to push it as much as one over here.
I see.
Because I think there's a better market in the States for this the sort of stuff that we're doing.
Oh man, people love Herman's Hermits.
Mm-hmm. And so. the new album, we've actually finished the album.
Is it like Herman's Hermits, or is it something different?
No, it's a bit harder than Herman's Hermits stuff. But
okay.
I mean, there's a couple of tracks that are quite soft and gentle.
I'm hoping that we're going to be able to hear a little bit of it today.
Sorry?
I'm hoping that we're going to be able to
Well,
hear
I've got a rough mix of the album. I'm still waiting on the masters to come from England at the moment.
Okay.
But I've got a mix, if you want to just play a couple of tracks.
How long is your mix?
The actual mix, well, it's a whole album of the tracks are maybe 3 minutes each or something like that.
Okay,
you just
play
a part of some of them,
sure,
if you want.
Absolutely. Sounds great.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe after the spot. We have a few more minutes before the spot. And I know you've got plenty of musician friends in England and that you're still performing in England and your trip's back. Now, could you tell us a little bit more about your recent meeting with Peter Noon? He was the vocalist of the original Herman's Hermits.
That's right. Connor messaged me when I was in the States and said that Peter was in this area.
You have a Connor connection.
A Connor connection. Connor's my connection with the US at the moment.
Okay.
Yeah, he sort of organizes all the interviews.
You can have a million connections in the US and they still wouldn't be able to put you together with Peter Noon.
Mm-hmm.
There's something unique about
Well,
this
Connor's
particular.
A big, big, big Herman's Hermits fan.
Uh-huh.
I mean, even though he's only a young man,
uh-huh.
he likes all the. I think Herman's Hermits were your favorite band.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does it make you a lunatic, Connor?
No.
He is a lunatic.
I think I'm a lunatic.
I posted this on the lunatic board, online, and I'm getting bang, bang, bang on over there. It's
great,
strong.
So, yeah, he said, did I want to go to the concert? And I said, yeah, love to.
Where was this?
It was in Elgin. Is it Elgin or Elgin?
Elgin.
Elgin. Okay, in England we say Elgin.
Ah, okay.
But anyway, it was in Elgin, Illinois.
At least
in a big part.
Illinois.
Illinois. Yeah, I've been here long enough to realize that it's Illinois. Yeah.
Okay.
So we went, and I actually went backstage to see him for the first time since the late 90s.
Oh, how nice.
Had a chat, remembered... We remembered when we were 15.
Sure.
He actually remembered me riding around on my mum's bike with a wicker basket on the front and my guitar stuck in it. Yeah, we used to ride around to go to rehearsals and things.
Cool.
Yeah. And it was really nice to see him. I met his band for the first time.
Okay.
The rest of the guys in the band. I've spoken to a couple of them on Facebook, but I've never actually met the guy.
I see.
And then I watched the show and I was very impressed. It was a great show. It was a surreal experience for me to actually sit in an audience watching these guys play my songs.
Sure.
Wow. And it was quite emotional, really.
Uh-huh. Is there any possibility that you might play with them anytime in the future?
I'm always up for it, yeah. If he wanted to, I'd go and do a few songs with him, yeah. No problem. I'd love to.
We're hoping for that. I think everybody would like to see that.
Oh,
yeah.
Sure, sure.
I mean, I'm up for a get back together with Barry, Keith and Peter and myself, but it's down to the other guys who, two of them don't talk to each other now, so it's one of those that usually happens within bands, bickering and all that stuff. But my idea is, we're all getting older.
Yeah.
And we've got to do it before while we can.
That's
we should get for the fans get together and give the fans a good old show once before we all drop off the perch.
That sounds really good. Really good. We're going to have to take a break right now. Two of the four members of the Karl Green Band, a.k.a. KGB, missing from our studio today due to prior commitments are Bob Abrams and Gina Knight, the other two members of the KGB. Could I ask you gentlemen to play?
But you do have Connor Mahoney here.
Connor Mahoney is
here. I am here.
There he is.
Uh-huh. I got some business to take up with you, Mr.
All right.
So, but if you gentlemen could play us a tune, I would be deeply in your debt.
Yeah, we'll feature Michael again on the vocals, singing a very sweet song written by a good friend of mine, Graham Gouldman, who also played with 10cc and various other bands.
Okay.
Cool. This is a song that was featured in a song called Where the Boys Meet the Girls, starring Connie Francis. We did a cameo, and it's called Listen People.
Cool.
Listen, people,
that everybody's got to love somebody sometime. Everybody's got to win a heart. Everybody's got to love somebody sometime. When you do, I hope you'll never part. I once found love just like you.
Clams, and it was me.
I love that. I've always loved that song.
Too early in the day for that one.
It's a lovely song.
It is.
Beautiful.
Very nice. Very nice. Now, of all peculiarities in the world, how in the heck did it come about that you met Connor Mahoney?
I'm afraid it's down to Facebook.
Not that Connor's peculiar, no, but the coincidence of you being in England, he being in Chesterton, Indiana. How did you guys get together?
Well, Connor was in touch with Peter quite a lot, with going to his concerts. I think he made friends with Peter on Facebook to start with, and then he used to go to his concerts. And then I think Connor found me on Facebook.
Yeah.
And contacted me, said, hi, I'm a friend of Herman's Hermits. So I friended him. And then he said, would I be prepared to come to the States and play?
Cool. Really?
And I had been 34 years retired from the music business. I'd brought my family up.
This is all Connor's fault.
Yeah, it's all my fault.
And Connor knew Mike, and Mike had the band, and Mike had been with playing in Peter's Herman's Hermits for a while. So it all kind of fit together.
That's so nice. What a great story.
And it's one of those things that was meant to happen, I think. And there's a lot of things in life that are written, I think.
Yeah.
And the rest is history.
He's your rep in the US?
Yeah, Connor looks after my business interests over here and books.
And I know, most communications between you and I go through Chesterton, Indiana.
That's right.
Which is peculiar, you know. I have no reason to deal with Chesterton.
Well, I don't even call it Chesterton anymore. I call it Connerson now.
That's it. They're probably going to rename it after Connor. So now, when you're in the U.S., Connor spends a significant amount of time with you. And I believe, although I may be wrong, that Connor sets up most of your engagements, most of the performances?
Yeah, he sort of arranges for me to go and guest with people or whatever.
Now, what in the world are we going to do when Connor moves to California?
Well, he'll still be working online, and I'm hoping to move to California eventually.
Are you?
I'm going to celebrate.
Oh,
I'm kidding. We're going to miss you, Connor.
Okay, all right. Connor, we're all going to miss you.
All right, thank you. I miss you guys too.
Please don't go.
Do you want to play another tune, or should we play some cuts off of your new album?
You could try playing a cut off the album, I think. I'm not sure which track it is. I think it's track the third from the end.
Okay, let's go back.
Two, three.
Track number 9?
Yeah, just try that one. It's probably the one I want to play the one that Mike's singing on.
Okay, we're only going to play like 30 seconds.
Yeah, fine.
Okay. And let me open up the channel before we lose that opportunity.
And again, this is Mike on vocals.
Okay.
Hopefully.
Hopefully, yeah. If I've got it right. Yeah. There's nothing new. Dead air, folks.
Yeah, I was just thinking, okay, then.
Wow. What track would you like?
It's probably the next one.
Okay. Although that sounded interesting.
That was Karl singing.
Okay. That was Karl, really?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Cool.
Sounded good. You know what the name of that song is?
Cause of You.
Cause of You.
But remember, you want to cut it in just a couple seconds.
And a little girl for like 10 seconds.
Yeah, just let the hook play.
What was the first one called?
The next one is...
No, the first one, the one that...
Cause of You, Cause of You.
Well, that was kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
I like that.
Yeah?
Good. Yeah.
Very cool.
That's called Ain't That Love For You, Baby?
Yeah, yeah.
That sounds
good. And all the songs are written by me. And a friend that I write songs with back in England.
Okay.
And on the album, not on that actually mix you've got, but there is a track, a bonus track on the album with Leck playing on it, believe it or not.
Really?
A track that I found that I wrote back in the 70s and did nothing with. I've just have found the demo and I had Leck come in. He walked past the bedroom I was doing the demo in and he said, do you want a solo putting on that? So I said, yeah, great.
Okay, now listen, all you listeners out there, all you people that have been on our show or that haven't been on our show that have been telling me that you write down all these tunes, that you never get back to them again, you might never get back to them again. Here's a witness to the fact that many, many years later, you can get back to those tracks and make them into popular songs.
Mm-hmm.
There's no statute of limitation on songwriting.
That's
so.
Right, yeah.
It seems like there's a song there, too, like, listen, people, no, huh?
To what he says. Okay, now, should we play the last track?
Yeah, the last one is called Put Your Money Where Your Mouth Is.
And here's Put Your Money Where Your Mouth Is. But the one that I shouldn't have played, what was that one called?
Because of You.
Because of You. I'm going to leave it in there and we'll have to identify it for syndicated station.
Cause, like abbreviation of because,
yeah.
COS.
COS.
Oh,
right.
Oh.
Because of You.
All right.
In the UK, it's COS.
Cool.
Just
that's
a little
cool.
Snippet.
Whoa.
That's great. Very, very nice.
Snippet of a ditty.
And when is cool. That little devil going to make the market?
Well, I'm still waiting for the masters to arrive from London.
Okay.
They should be arriving this week. As soon as they do, we'll get them out to the record company. They will press, and it should be in on Amazon and on iTunes, and we will have hard copy to sell over the internet sites that we've got.
Okay.
Who mastered this album, by the way?
It was mastered, believe it or not, by Keith Hopwood's son.
Yeah, Keith
Hopwood.
Cool.
Yeah, and I mixed at Keith Hopwood's studio.
That's crazy.
We recorded it here in Chicago, and then I took all of the stem files back to London, tidied them up at home, and then went up to Keith's studio in Manchester.
Wow.
Spent a couple of weeks with him mixing it.
Wow, nice.
And then I left them with Daniel, his son, who's a very good master of records. He's mastered everything.
Very good.
He's sent it over, so we're just waiting for the actual masters to arrive here. As soon as they arrive, we'll be doing the business.
Well, why are we waiting for those masters to arrive? Do you think you could lay another tune on us?
Yeah. This is my favourite of all the stuff that we did over the years. It's called There's a Kind of Hush All Over the World. There's a kind of hush all over the world.
Cool. They're just fun. They're just fun songs, you know. They're positive. There's nothing, not a drop of anything negative in those songs. It's just, and they're so well done too.
They're good tunes, aren't they? Very well written songs.
Something my mom let me listen to. See?
Hmm? And your mom was pretty.
He knew my mom. She fixed us up.
That's true. Al Weissman, in a nutshell, that was There's a Kind of Hush, performed by Karl Green, original bassist for Herman's Hermits. Who should know, because he was there in the 60s strumming on the old bass. Now, I noticed, Carol, the old bass isn't with us today.
No, I've just brought an acoustic. That's why I can't remember half the
oh, really?
The chords.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Because the bass patterns are completely different than the actual chords.
Sure. You know?
But I'm just strumming along.
Also performing, Mike Bruccoleri, two of the four members of the Carol Green Band. And sitting here enjoying the whole thing is Connor Mahoney and Marge.
I am.
Hi, Mom.
Thank you. Hi, Carl.
Hello.
You still like my blue bonnet, Carl?
After
all these years.
I have to ask Mike Bruccoleri a few questions.
Oh.
Because I actually have been kind of like after you to come on our show for a while here.
That's true.
And
you got me.
And I didn't want to make you come all the way from
Valpo?
Valparaiso. How far is that from Chesterton?
8 miles?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, you guys are practically neighbors.
Yeah.
In fact, in Indiana, you probably are neighbors.
We are. He's just up the road.
Yeah.
Three farms away.
See that? Do you live on a farm, too?
I live in a subdivision that's surrounded by farms.
Oh, okay.
Cool.
And so I'm looking at your bio, and you're the rhythm guitarist for this band. So tell us a little bit about yourself. Where were you born, first of all? Were you born in Valparaiso?
He was born, for sure.
Born in New York.
New York?
Yeah.
How in the hell did you wind up in Valparaiso, Indiana?
I don't know, I got lost.
I'd say.
Wrong turn at Albuquerque.
No. Valparaiso, states like Indiana and Ohio.
Indiana.
Shuffle them off the map.
Hey,
I blame, well, I love Carl can name his relocation on me and Connor, but I blame mine on Peter Noon. Because I was playing with Peter Noon at the Star Plaza in Merrillville.
Okay.
One of those big Salute to the 60s shows, and that's where I met my to-be wife. My wife-to-be, yes. I met her in 2004.
Oh, that's how you wound up in Valparaiso.
That's right.
She's a native of Valparaiso, or that area.
That's right. She was attending the show at the Star Plaza.
And
got to meet her there, and, you know, the rest is history.
Are you from New York City originally?
Yeah, born in the city, Brooklyn.
Really?
Yeah.
So you went to school, you grew up going to school in Brooklyn?
Yep.
And you learned your first instrument in Brooklyn?
No, I don't think I picked up guitar. Yeah, I didn't pick up guitar until I came to... Oh, no, that's not true. I learned...
You gotta talk right into the mic so people can
hear
you.
You have to stop fighting with yourself first, though,
Mike. Can you hear me now?
I think I
started playing piano, a little bit of piano back in Brooklyn, but I really didn't get into music till we moved out to Long Island.
Okay.
We call it Long Island.
Long Island.
What music did you... How old were you when you played the piano?
Five.
Okay, until when?
So you think I'd be really good by now, huh? Yeah. I played it from age five till age five and a half.
Oh,
that's
okay.
The problem.
That would be a problem.
Yeah.
And then after that, you went for... How long was it before you got into your next instrument?
Well, it was around age 11 where I asked my mom and dad for a guitar.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I was actually inspired. I went to school with two... in the same school district, we had Joe Satriani.
Okay.
Who was... He didn't go to our school district, but he was just always there and hanging out with Steve Vai, who I did graduate
with. Okay, cool.
So it was one of those two boys I saw with their guitar, and I said, "Hey, Ma and Dad, can I have one of those?" And they got me one for Christmas.
Very nice. Very, very cool.
Yeah.
And then when you were in high school, did you participate in any organized high school musical activities?
Not till just after high school, just after I graduated. My girlfriend at the time was a total Beatlehead.
Okay.
Right around the time John Lennon got shot.
Oh, my.
We decided we were going to start a band. She just wouldn't stop crying for 3 weeks.
Oh.
A lot of people were like that.
Yeah. So to console her, I said, "Well, what if we started our own band and took over from where they left off, you know, like some crazy dream or whatever." But
sure.
That was my first band. And that was when I first started getting serious about learning guitar and making a tight band.
About
1981. When did you,
Looking at me. When John Lennon died.
You know rock and roll history.
1980.
So yeah, it was about the beginning of 81 is where I started my first
band. I thought you were asking me when I started your first
band. I was asking you when you shot John Lennon.
Oh, yeah.
What a loathsome guy. You know, that guy, every once in a while, he comes up to try and get out of jail. And
right.
I just, you know, I just think about that son of a gun. You know, I mean, what a hateful person.
Yeah. But back to the good stuff.
Yeah.
And a happier note.
I just realized that you started your first band the year I gave up.
That's right.
Wow.
Look at that.
Yeah, 1980.
Oh,
I left the Hermits in 1980, and you started a band in 1980.
Pass the torch.
Cool.
Do you have any brothers or sisters?
Older brother, younger sister.
Dana
and Diane High.
Are either of them musical?
No. Nope.
Parents musical?
I have one musical cousin. My cousin John is a genius. He's amazing.
Yeah?
He's one of those guys that play with. He plays classical guitar with six fingers on each hand. Very, very good.
That's hard to do.
Yeah.
So, is he like a professional musician?
Yeah, he is.
Okay. Now, let's see here. Besides being in the Karl Green Band, you're presently in Rack and Abrams with Bob Abrams.
Yes, sir.
And you mentioned previously that you were in Herman's Hermits with Peter Newman.
That's right.
When was that?
03 till 06.
Okay. How did that come about?
How did I get the phone call? I've been friends with the musical director. His name is Vance Brescia.
Okay.
Since
musical
about,
director of what?
He's the musical director of Peter Noon's band.
Oh, okay.
Herman's Hermits starring Peter Noon. I've known Vance since about 1982 or 83. And for years, we just kind of traded with each other. He'd put me on a gig. I'd put him on a gig. And it was June of 2003.
That's cool. That's a nice relationship.
Mm-hmm.
May of 2003, actually, he gave me the call and said, "Drive up to Connecticut. We're playing a show. The Hermits are playing a show. And I want you to meet Peter Noon." So I drove up. And at soundcheck, he said, "Hey, grab that bass guitar and play a song." And it was kind of a hush. And I was like, "Okay, great." And he goes, "You know what? You just auditioned for the band." And the next day, Peter Noon called me up and he says, "I want you in my band." I'm a spoiled brat.
Cool.
Get what I want. I was like, "All right."
How cool.
Yeah.
So you traveled with him for 3 years?
Yeah. About 200 shows.
Until you got to Valpo and where you settled down.
That's right.
And where you've lived ever after.
Happily ever after.
That's nice. Nice story. Can you guys play another tune for us before we have to take our next break?
Yeah. Yeah.
What?
Mike's going to play guitar and I'll sing this thing. It's the song that really made us very popular over here in 65. We were halfway through a Dick Clark Caravan of Stars tour, headlined by Bobby V, and this song went straight to number one, so we had to take over headlining the show, and it's called Mrs. Brown, You've Got a Lovely Daughter. Mrs. Brown, you've got a lovely daughter. Girls as sharp as her are something rare. But it's sad, she doesn't love me now. She's made it clear enough, it ain't no good to pine. She wants to return the things I bought her. Tell her she can keep them just the same. Things have changed, she doesn't love me now. She's made it clear enough, it ain't no good to pine. Walking about, even in a crowd, well, makes her both feel so proud. If she finds that I've been round to see you, tell her that I'm well and I'm feeling fine. Don't let on, don't say she broke my heart. I'd go down on my knees, but it's no good to pine. Walk about, walking about, even in a crowd, well, you pick her out. Makes her both feel so proud if she finds that I've been round to see you. Tell her that I'm well and I'm feeling fine. Don't let on, my knees, but it's no good to find. Mrs. Brown, you've got a lovely daughter. Mrs. Brown, you've got a lovely daughter. Mrs. Brown, you've got a lovely daughter.
Nice, love that song.
Cute song, isn't it?
I'm telling you, your music is just hitting the spot with me today. That's exactly what I needed. I have one more question for Mike, though.
Yes.
How in the heck did you get to play with the Coasters, the Drifters, Shadows of Night, Sonny Gracie, Gary Lewis, Johnny Farina of Santo and Johnny, the Chiffons, the Tokens, Billy Joe Royal, Gary DiCarlo of Steam? I mean, you've been a busy boy.
And now Karl Green?
And he's only 21.
How is it possible? No, I'll...
I know, they were all kicking you out one by one, right?
Yeah. I'll give credit
just
to...
Just kidding, I'm just kidding about that.
There's a fella named Dave Zine.
Okay.
He currently works with the Buckinghams and...
Blonde hair?
Yeah, and he's in with all those bands. He knows everybody, and the promoters call him and say, hey, can you assemble a band to back up such and such a guy?
Oh, really?
Whatever. Yeah, so they call him, and then he'll call me. So I thank him for that. Thank you, Dave.
Good guy to know. I mean, that's some pretty quality merchandise there. Now, Al Weissman here in a nutshell. Now, in Thanksgiving, Carl, you kind of said that you were considering the purchase of a residence in the greater Chicagoland area. Is that still in the hopper of things to come?
Yeah, I'm looking for somewhere to live, but as I said, I've got to try and get a green card first.
Okay.
Or get some sort of immigration status. But I'd like to live either here or right in California. I've got a lot of friends around here now.
Yeah, sure.
So, and, you know, I can just come here for a few weeks and go out different place every night and see different people. Go and see Mike play, Bobby play.
Yeah, sure.
And, yeah, I'm really enjoying it. I love this area, especially in the summer.
It's fantastic.
It's very beautiful, yeah. The winter kind of sucks.
So. Oh, yeah.
It's probably
not
too different from where you live.
Yeah, last time I was here, I was just saying to Connor, this place was just iced up. It was ice everywhere last time I was here.
I remember you were freezing your buns off when we were talking
about
the studio.
He only had a jean jacket on.
And on the trip here today, I noticed there's lots of lakes everywhere. It's lovely.
Yeah, Lake County is full of
lakes. Fantastic. Lots of nice, what you call cabins on the lake and all that sort of stuff. I love water. I love living near water. But being from London, I live right on the Thames.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, it's nice. Love it around here.
So you you mentioned that you have a couple of daughters.
I've got three daughters, yeah.
And I know one of them is a hair.
The youngest is a hairdresser. Yeah. She has her own business. Yeah.
What are the other two doing?
The middle one's a big manager for a big company, and she's just changed jobs. She just got headhunted, and she's running a company at the moment. She's in charge of all the PR work and stuff for a big company, and the oldest, she deals in antique jewellery, retro clothing, and she's also the PA for a big private school in London. She's the PA for the owner, sort of headmaster of this big private school.
Sounds like you did a good job.
Yeah, they're all doing well, they're all enjoying their lives. The middle one's just got back from travelling around Asia for 10 weeks. She took a sabbatical between jobs. She wanted to travel, you know, so she's just come back from Vietnam and Bali, all those sort of places. We had a really good time, yeah.
Cool. Very, very cool. Let's see here. And then there's a wild rumor flying around that you might be stopping by the Antioch's Taste of Summer. Is there any truth to that rumor?
Is that where Sean is? Yeah. I'm going to go, and there's a band, some friends of Connor's.
Right.
That I actually did there's an open mic night one night, and I went along and sang a couple of songs with them, and we had a ball. I love that they're young, they're enthusiastic.
Yeah.
They play great music, so I think I might just be doing a couple of numbers with them, just
nice.
For fun.
What's
the
name
of that band?
Sure.
The Sure. The Sure. That's right. Yeah.
Sure.
The Sure.
You know, you're not just stopping by to sample the Epicurean delights, to witness the work of the local crafters, to shop at the sidewalk sale, to ride the rides at the carnival.
That sounds like a commercial, yeah.
But you're there for some musical business, huh?
Yeah, I'm sure I'll have a look around and see what it's all about.
Cool. Well, can you play another tune for us, please?
Yeah, we'll do this song that was originally done by Sam Cooke. Mickey Mouse persuaded us to do it, and it was a big hit. It's called Wonderful World.
Cool. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Don't know much about history. Don't know much biology. Don't know much about science books. Don't know much about French I took. But I do know that I love you. And I do know you love me too. What a wonderful world this would be.
You guys are in good tune today.
Do this one. Yeah.
Sure.
Off you go.
Oh. All right. Connor, you gonna play the drums on this one?
Same as the first. I'm an idiot, I am. An idiot, I am. I got married to the widow next door. She's been married 7 times before. And everyone was an enery. Wouldn't have a wedding or a Sam.
Yes, sir.
I'm a red old man, I'm an enery. An idiot, I am. Guitar. The working name at the moment is A Long Road Back.
Okay, that sounds appropriate.
Uh-huh.
And when can we expect to see that on the market? It may not be. It may not be called A Long Road Back.
That's just the working title at the moment. We've got to we've got to work out the album artwork yet. And as soon as that's all done, hopefully, it will be out soon. Very soon.
Okay.
The sooner the better.
You'll let us know when.
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
Cool. And. What's your travel schedule like? You're only going to be in town now for, a few weeks, yeah?
I'm going home on the 3rd of August, I think it is.
Yeah.
But I'm going to a few parties while I'm here and just enjoying life and seeing friends and having fun, yeah.
When do you think you'll be back again?
Back here?
Yeah.
Hopefully, October sometime, hopefully.
Okay. So is there like a tour planned at some point in time?
Again, we'd like to tour, but I've just got to get my work visa sorted out. Because I can't really work until I get a proper visa.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just doing sort of guest appearances.
Sure.
You know, just do a few songs here, a few songs there. Not actually work. But,
yeah, I figured as much. So that was a thought that was always in the back of my mind.
Partying.
I figured you had that worked out pretty well.
Yeah.
And, so you're not really for hire, but if people wanted to get a hold of you, maybe to perform, would you be open for that?
Yeah. I'm working on, there's a couple of tours being talked about.
Okay.
But to get a work visa, you've got to have contracts. So I'm waiting for these people to come up with a tour so I can show contracts to the immigration.
Okay.
They will then say, yeah, we'll give you a visa. I mean, I've got 5 passports at home full of H-1 visas. So I'm sure I won't have a problem getting visas.
Sure.
That's why I want to be a good boy at the moment and not sort of rub them the wrong way.
Of course.
But when I've actually got the contracts for proper shows, then I'll go and see, and they'll probably give me an H-1 visa or something, that sort of thing.
Okay.
What I'd like to do is to try and get work sorted out for about a year, and eventually I want to move here.
That sounds like a plan.
Yeah.
Sounds like a good plan. Mm-hmm.
And while I'm here, I'm just going to get in touch with the immigration and see what the score is. You know, get a proper appraisal of what my chances are of moving here. And because I know it's getting tougher to get in here.
Yeah.
But I can look after myself. I can afford to support myself, so it's all right.
Well, it depends on who gets elected. The next time around, it might get tougher to get in here, or it may not get tougher, so we'll have to see about that. I don't like to get political.
Mm-hmm.
So if someone wanted to get a hold of you, I suppose they'd do that through Connor?
Through Connor, yeah. Get a hold of Connor.
Mm-hmm.
And you're... how do people get a hold of you?
Email cj.mahoney928@gmail.com or find me on Facebook.
Mahoney, 928 at gmail.com
or message the Karl Green Original Bassist of Herman's Hermits Facebook page.
Oh, that's a good way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Right. And would that also be true for the KGB?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Right. We do have a website for the KGB.
Yes,
we have
karlgreenband.com.
That's it.
Very cool. Very cool. And how about yourself?
Do I have a website?
How do people get a hold of you?
People can find
me. Are you
open
to it? I mean, if somebody, let's say somebody wanted to hire you for a wedding, a bar mitzvah, a circumcision.
Bar mitzvah, yeah. Circumcision.
Get out of jail party.
I do bristles, by the way.
Do you?
No.
You sign your work?
Go to Facebook and then look for Mike Bruccoleri Music. That's it?
That's it?
Yeah.
On Facebook?
Yeah.
How do you spell Bruccoleri?
Yeah, that's a tough one.
You don't know how to spell Bruccoleri?
Nope.
It's Bruccoleri. Mike Bruccoleri Music. At Facebook.
Yeah, fortunately, by now my computer has been trained, so all I have to do is type in Mike Broc, and the rest of it pops up there. So.
That's right.
But I feel. Sometimes you call yourself Brock.
Yeah. Well, Bruccoleri is a little bit tough. I'm proud of my Sicilian heritage, and my grandpa said, Mike, this is how it's pronounced. Stick with it, be proud of it. So I try to use Bruccoleri as much as I could. Some places, though, can't deal with it. And they just shorten it to Mike Brock or Mick Brock.
The hell with them. Uh-huh. Yeah. All of their name. They have to learn how to speak.
Yeah. Yeah, Mickey Brock is his rock and roll name.
That's right.
Our language is, our country's English is full of all kinds of idiosyncratic pronunciations due to the variety of the people that we have here. And people just have to get used to that.
That's right.
So,
you tell them.
So if they wanted to get a hold of you, that's where they would do that.
That's right.
Okay, very good. Gentlemen, thank you so very, very much.
Yes, it's a pleasure.
We have to play. I've got some recording by Jimmy Sands that they would.
Okay.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's cool.
We met with Jimmy Sands last week,
mm-hmm.
and we recorded about a half an hour of interview with him where he talks about.
I got his whole thing on Comcast on this Saturday. So.
Yeah, but I think I think he would be disappointed.
Okay. Did he do Brown Eyed Squirrel?
He didn't sing anything, but he sure did ramble.
We know.
Yeah, okay, thank you so very much again for coming around today.
Pleasure.
I really do appreciate it. Look forward to seeing you on the 18th.
Mm-hmm.
And that'll be a ball. And some people say that I'm going to be emceeing this project, which I haven't verified yet, but.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you will.
But you'll definitely be there, yeah?
I'll look forward to seeing you. He's kidding. He's emceeing.
We actually provided 7 hours of entertainment.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Right.
So I guess I have to be there.
I just get pointed in the direction by Connor. He sort of points me in the direction I just go and do.
It's like 2 blocks from where we live.
Sometimes it's
right near
direction.
Our house.
Yeah.
So
it's very conveniently located.
For us.
Right. Okay. Very good. We'll see you there. Someone, thank you again.
No problem.
Pip, pip.
Cheerio.
Cheerio. Pip, pip. What? Ta-ta for now.
And all that rot.
All right. We're going to play. We met with Jimmy Sands last week, who's the lead singer on The Shadows of Night. We interviewed him. He had a lot to talk about, a lot on his mind, although less than he did last time. Last time we interviewed him, it was 3 hours.
Do you do most of the interviewing, or does he just not stop talking?
No, he just keeps going. Every once in a while, I kind of like try to give him a little direction, you know, to remind him that we started talking about this, and even though we're up in 6 different things now, I really would kind of like to get back to that.
Yeah.
And then he does. You know, he's very compliant with that, and that makes it.
He's got a lot to talk about.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true. This time around, we were only there for about 40 or 45 minutes, and I was able to pare it down to about 28 minutes.
It felt like 7 hours, so I left the house because I was there.
You were there.
Well, no, we spent an hour listening to his music.
I look up and I see Connor heading out the front door. He's bailing on the situation.
With his backpack.
He's going over to see Karl.
Yes, I was. That's right.
Yeah, that's what you said.
Yep.
Okay, so here's the interview with Jimmy Sands, and we will be back.
Ain't that love for you, baby?
In a nutshell.